with Irene and David of the Coalition to Protect Chinatown and the Lower East Side, which is also part of the rally in front of City Hall that took place this past Sunday. There were a lot of Asians, Asian Americans and Latino Americans at this rally, asking Bill de Blasio, I was going to say Donald Trump, Bill de Blasio to step down because he basically sold out to big real estate developers. Either Irene or David, thank you for interviewing me. This is for the peoplesinternetradio.com that I'm going to play this evening between 6 and 8 p.m. Eastern time.
Thank you for having us.
Yeah, thanks for having us.
Yeah, so go ahead. So what was the rally about on Sunday?
I just wanted to say your slip about asking Donald Trump to step down was actually very appropriate to, some of what we were raising at the rally. It was actually on Monday, on Martin Luther King Day. And members of the alliance specifically chose that because we really wanted to emphasize the reclaiming of a legacy of Dr. King, who fought against racial injustice and economic injustice, and reclaim that legacy and that message with actual fight that we're currently engaged with. Where communities of color, low-income communities of color, are under attack, really, by the mayor's rezoning policies, which are very fundamentally racist, and because they disproportionately impact communities of color and are pushing people out as luxury developers are coming in and building with the explicit permission of Mayor de Blasio's rezoning policies. There's a lot of context from where that comes from, where he's currently being investigated for corruption charges, and there's clearly some ties for him and his own political aspirations to be building close relationships with developers that can financially benefit from building luxury developments and pushing out the communities that currently live in these neighborhoods, and essentially destroying the very fabric of these communities. And what I was referencing earlier when I was talking about your slip with saying Donald Trump is that, we really see Mayor de Blasio, while he claims to be the savior of New York City to protect immigrants and communities of color against the openly, the open racism and oppression that Trump is, acting out and showing, Mayor de Blasio is actually doing very similar kinds of racist policies, but sort of hiding behind, sort of disguising those policies as actually trying to create affordability for the community. But the real question is, who's actually able to afford any of those apartments, and who is he actually pushing out in that process?
So I was just speaking with Roger Hernandez, and he is up in the East Harlem area. He was talking about the changes that have been going on up there. But there were a lot of people at the rally that, the focus was also Chinatown. Your website called peoplefirstnyc.org, Coalition to Protect Chinatown and the Lower East Side. So the same thing has been basically going on in Chinatown and the Lower East Side as is in the East Harlem area?
Yeah, it's essentially the same struggle. And that's why we came together with other communities like East Harlem, like the South Bronx, like Brooklyn and Queens. It's the same thing that's happening all throughout the five boroughs. You know, specifically what we see happening in Chinatown, Lower East Side, is that we saw a huge influx of development, luxury development, happen starting in the Bloomberg era when he passed the East Village rezoning plan in 2008. That plan intentionally gave height limits to the much wealthier and white part of our community board so that luxury development could not occur there, but excluded the, you know, Chinatown, Lower East Side, which are predominantly low income and people of color, where right now there's no height limits whatsoever. So developers can literally build to the sky if they had enough space, you know, if they have the enough land. So, you know, our community came together during that time, Black, Latino, Chinese, white, to say no to racism. And, you know, thousands of people took to the streets, but the Bloomberg administration, you know, disregarded the outcry from the community, passed a plan. And, you know, since then we've seen, for example, on the Lower East Side waterfront, there are at least four new skyscrapers that are going to be built right next to public housing. Each of these skyscrapers is going to rise at least 60 to 100 stories high. You know, we're talking about buildings that rival the World Trade Center, that rival the Empire State Building, that rival, you know, Midtown Manhattan.
And they're going to be residential?
Yes, all residential. And the developers who are building them, Extel, JDS, L&M, Starrett Corporation, these are, you know, people know them as developers for the 1%. We're not talking about affordable housing. We're talking about housing for the, you know, like, you know, not even, I mean, housing, but also like places where the world's rich basically come and stash their money in real estate. So, you know, our community, instead of just being simply reactive, we came together, we created our own rezoning plan, which would put height limits throughout the neighborhood and end the onslaught of luxury development in our community. We call it the People's First Rezoning Plan, and it was eventually adopted by what is known as the Chinatown Working Group. So last year, you know, thousands of people in our community actually marched down to City Hall twice, calling on Mayor de Blasio to pass this rezoning plan. Many people were hoping that he would represent a break from Bloomberg, you know, especially since he had promised to tackle income inequality, that he would promise to end the tale of two cities. But his response to thousands of people marching down to City Hall was to say that, well, this plan is too ambitious. It's not feasible.
The plan that you were presenting him is too ambitious?
Correct.
See, like, you know, you got to be kidding me. I'm sorry. Like, sometimes I get, like, so irate. I mean, it's ridiculous. Your plan is too ambitious, but big real estate development, no, they're not too ambitious.
Right. You're absolutely right.
You got to be kidding me.
I wish it was a joke.
I mean, seriously, like, is that a joke? I mean, that's like ridiculous. Right, you know, like the people wanting their rightful crumb is like, you know, you're asking for too much, too ambitious.
Right.
You gotta be
kidding. That's why we demonstrated down in City Hall. That's why we're calling on the mayor to step down. That's why we're, you know, working with other communities across the city to build a citywide alliance. Because while he rejected a people's plan, he's imposing his own, like you said, developer-led plan upon communities like, you know, East Harlem, like the South Bronx, like Flushing, like East New York. If you look at every neighborhood that he's targeted through his rezoning plan, there's one thing that's, you know, one thing that all these communities have in common. They're predominantly low-income. They're predominantly you know, people of color, neighborhoods, communities where traditionally, you know, immigrants came to settle. So that's why we're calling on him to step down. We see that there's no, you know, reasoning with a mayor that is deep in the pockets of developers. You know, no matter how accommodating you try to be, no matter how reasonable you try to be, he's never going to listen. And, you know, we've, you know, every, you know, we see that, you know, all of our communities are going through the same experience. So the most logical thing to do is to call on a mayor like that to step down. You know, there's no, he has no rightful place in a democratic society, a mayor like that, an elected official like that. And we're calling, you know, our Citywide Alliance is also calling on the city to adopt rezoning plans that that are like the Chinatown Working Group plan, based, community-based, people-first rezoning plan. Also, another demand that we've put forward is that the city must end all public funding for luxury development and stop using public resources and public land and public assets to help developers build more luxury high-rises. And
I mean, this, you know, is, this should be criminal. I mean, this, what I'm listening to is criminal, what you're saying. I mean, Roger Hernandez said the same thing, that it's public funds that are being used, like, from the, you know, I mean, not only, like, you know, the poor people that they're screwing, you know, like other people too, I'm sure, you know, middle class people, whatever, but the fact that, I mean, like, this just like reeks of criminality.
You're absolutely right.
Yeah.
100% right.
And you know, because they're the ones in power making up the stuff. They can just do whatever they want, including, like, be criminals. I mean, it's complete bullying what you're describing. It's just that simple.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And something must be done.
I think also, I mean, when we talk about displacement, you know, I think it can feel, you can feel sort of disconnected from that word, right? It's like, okay, some people have to move, right? But I think there's a much bigger picture of what displacement actually indicates. You know, it's like for generations, people have grown up in certain neighborhoods and they have built relationships with each other, like, you know, the bodega on the corner, right, or a mom and pop shop down the street. They've gone to school with, you know, with other kids in the neighborhood, or their families know each other, or they've lived in the same buildings. Anyways, like, these generations of relationship building and, you know, interaction creates, like, the fabric of a community, you know, where people, you know, like, you know, have fights with each other, disagree about things, or fight for things together. You know, it's like, it's a whole history. And when displacement happens, and, you know, with the stroke of a pen, and, you know, luxury developments come in, and all of a sudden, all of that history and all of that unique culture to each neighborhood is completely erased. Right. And it's, you know, I mean, it's a huge, I mean, it's a major impact that when we just, we use the word displacement, we use the word gentrification, people kind of, you know, people understand what that means, but there's a whole, you know, there's a bigger impact of human relations and, you know, tradition and culture that's sort of embedded in each community that makes up what it is. And that totally gets annihilated. And that is, I mean, it's like modern day genocide in a way, you know?
Absolutely.
And
it is.
And I think,
it's
you know,
completely
when we use these
is.
Terms casually, sometimes we forget that the depth of the impact on human lives and on histories and on, you know, people's cultures and people, the uniqueness of neighborhoods and what people have built over all this time.
If either one of you can kind of give like a bit of a brief sort of timeline, like when did this start and how, like, has it progressed? Roger, again, like, no, I'm sorry, it was just David who talked about 100 stories tall. I mean, who's gonna live in these buildings? Who's gonna fill these buildings? And if I could just quickly say this last thing, because how I learned about this was through the shutting down of the libraries, the organization that are they're trying to hold on to the libraries that they've shrunken down, gotten rid of in order to build the luxury condos on top, turn them into luxury condos, or build luxury condos on top of the diminished library. Mm-hmm. And that was like about a year or so ago. So yeah, like when did this start, this whole gentrification and displacement in these neighborhoods?
So I think if there are any listeners that are interested in a comprehensive history of gentrification, there was a book that was released recently called Zoned Out. It's edited by Tom Ngadi, who is the chair of the urban planning studio at Hunter College. He himself was a former lead planner at the Department of City Planning. I think he worked there during the Koch era, or if I'm wrong, it might have been Dinkins. And so he actually quit out of protest, because during his time there, he saw that there was a systemic attempt to target low-income communities of color specifically for gentrification and displacement to usher in what we're seeing the city become now, this all this onslaught of luxury development that swallowed up all these communities now. Specifically, we saw that, the real, a lot of this began to, I wouldn't say began, but it really began to intensify the gentrification under the Bloomberg years. Like I said, for us in the Chinatown and Lower East Side community, that began with the 2008 East Village rezoning plan. But if you read his Tommy Gotti's book, it puts the context of what happened in our neighborhood with what was happening throughout the city during that time. And what you saw happen during the Bloomberg era was, it's often said, Bloomberg rezoned more communities across the city than even Robert Moses did, more communities than any other mayor in the history of New York City. And you could see very deliberately what he did was he targeted communities of color that were predominantly low income for what are called upzonings, meaning that the development potential in those neighborhoods were increased so that, you can see like in Harlem, there are proposals to build 50, story skyscrapers on their waterfront. In Chinatown, Lower East Side, you see the 60 to 100 story skyscrapers coming in. If you looked over to, across the river at Williamsburg, Brooklyn, here was a community that was very diverse. Puerto Rican, Dominican, Jewish, Polish, you name it, they were there. If you look at that waterfront, the only thing that you see nowadays are skyscrapers. A lot of this really, I would say, intensified under the Bloomberg era. And, as a coalition, we tried, to be proactive during the years that followed the 2008 East Village rezoning. We tried to create our own rezoning plan. And we offer that actually as a model to other communities across the city. Like, this is the way that we can come together and fight back against the onslaught of luxury development. It's really very simple. If you pass a height limit on the community so that no developer can build above a certain height, they have no incentive to come in right. and buy up the land in your community. And that also has a positive influence on the rent as well. The more development potential there is, the higher the property taxes, the more that you will pay for rent, the more that the small business on the corner of your block is going to pay for rent. So, therefore, the more displacement that you see. It's really that simple. If the de Blasio administration was genuine, about fighting for racial, social, economic equality, they would work with communities all across the city, pass these community-based rezoning plans to stop luxury development. And I think, just to answer your other question, who is living in these towers? I think that's the ultimate irony. Almost no one lives in these towers. Actually, what all this luxury development is doing is turning our city into a tax haven for the world's super rich and the most corrupt, elected officials in the world. And I'll give you an example of that. Excel which is one of the developers who's currently building an 80-story skyscraper.
Name names. That's exactly what you should name some names, like name like whatever the other developers or whoever else is involved in this stuff, because that's what needs to happen. Okay, go ahead. I didn't mean to
interrupt
you.
Right, so they're currently trying to build an 80-story skyscraper on our waterfront. And actually, that the name Extel may be familiar to a lot of people out there. You know, they're most famous for their tower, Tower 57, which is 57th Street between 6th and 7th Avenue. It's the tallest residential tower, I believe, possibly in the world, but definitely in New York City. It rises like 75 stories. Anyway, so the top level of that, you know, top level of the penthouse of that tower was bought by, was sold off for $100 million recently. The biggest, real estate sale in history. Comes to find out that I believe what happened was so connected to the building, the financing of the building was the Prime Minister of Indonesia, who was recent, I may be mixing up my facts, it was either Indonesia or Malaysia, but turns to find out that he had purchased units there in order to hide the money that he was stealing from the public treasury of his country. So I think, you know, this is kind of, common, a common thing that we see happen across, all these luxury towers. You know, it's a very convenient way for elected officials in the world's most corrupt nations to come and stash their money, especially given the fact that the city and the state is offering, has given, tax-free bonds and tax-free subsidies to, developers to build these units. So here's when an individual buys one of these units, they can actually, it's completely tax-free. So it becomes like a bank account, tax-free banking account for these corrupt officials.
So that's it's called 157.
Right.
I was trying to read about it on Business Insider, but it wouldn't. It put a block thing up because I have ad blocker on my computer, which sometimes I was just trying to see. You said you wasn't sure if it was Indonesia, so I was trying to see, that was the person who bought it. So it was sold. You said.
I don't mean that particular unit. I just mean like some of the financing for that development actually came from this corrupt official. Again, I can't remember if it was Malaysia or.
It in this article in the New York
actually Times. I'm looking at an article of it now. Actually, it is linked to the Prime Minister of Malaysia. It was actually pretty big news at one point. The news of it broke out on March 2016.
What article are you looking at?
The New York Post.
Okay, I'm in the New York Times. I don't see anything about somebody from.
Here's the title. The headline is 157 Tower Linked to Global Money Laundering Probe. And so just actually much more. Yeah.
And so, another one for the New York Times. It says Indonesia's dire need for, maybe that's something else. That might be about something else, unfortunately. How progress has been made in halting this stuff? What do you have to do, right, to get this stuff halted, to, put the brakes? One thing I was going to ask, because, not for nothing, but New York City is very old. I mean, things are kind of old and there's so many tall buildings built on it. I mean, isn't there some sort of I mean, what if like the ground just can't hold all of this weight? I mean, is there any of that kind of consideration going, you know, that has to be or do they not even check for that? Do they not even check if the ground underneath can even handle the weight of this?
For the most part, no. There's no consideration whatsoever.
I mean, yeah, what if it just collapses, literally? Like, what if the ground just collapses because it's just like, it just can't?
So, at least on the books, there is a, you know, environmental review process that, you know, if for a major rezoning, like say if a whole community is rezoned, there, you know, the city is required by law to conduct an environmental impact statement. But what we found in our experience, and this is actually detailed in the book that I mentioned earlier, Zoned Out, it's a phony process. It's just, you know, the city literally writes in every single, I mean, does not conduct any study whatsoever and just uses it to rubber stamp every single rezoning and redevelopment initiative that it puts forward. There's no real public review, no real environmental assessment that's done. And actually speaking about,
right, if they don't care about the people, they don't care about who they're displacing, then it's like, of course, they're not going to take the environment or the structure. I'm not an architect or an engineer. I don't know, like, if there's like a technical term for what it's called when you have to take into consideration the ground that you're building on, but I'm sure there's some name for it that needs to kind of be looked into or taken into consideration.
So again, just mentioning the 80-story tower that's being built on our waterfront by Excel, when they were laying the foundation of that building earlier in the summer of 2016, the stress of all that work being done actually cracked the foundation of a publicly subsidized building that is right next door.
Exactly.
So people, for instance, were, you know, like if you visit the building, you can still see to this day, you know, there are floors that are sloped, where, you know, floors that were even before ceilings. You know, you could see a clear separation where the ceiling and the walls meet. You know, there are huge cracks in people's walls throughout their apartments. There are some people who can't close their windows, again, because of the way that the foundation of the building has shifted. And I mean, speaking about like weight bearing, you know, over the summer at one point, the sidewalk along the construction site actually literally sank by 2 inches.
Really? See, that's exactly what I'm talking about. I mean, these people are crazy. They're crazy. They really
are.
This
is publicly documented. And despite that, exactly, not a single elected official has stepped to the plate to say, hey, we got to put a stop to this. This kind of construction is actually a danger to people's lives.
There's I just wanted to say that, I mean, there's a Wikipedia page about it. It said there was a crane collapse on October the 29th of 2012. Oh, it was during Hurricane Sandy. The construction at 157 on the building partially collapsed, causing thousands of residents and hotel guests in the neighborhood to be evacuated. And then also a fire on the evening of March 15th, 2014, a fire broke out in the loading dock of 157, spreading into the courtyard behind the building and then into adjacent property at 152 West 58th Street, which had to be evacuated. And neither Extel nor Lend-Lease has ever offered any explanation of the fire. And the New York City Department of Buildings did not issue a partial stop work order following the fire. The cause of the fire remains a mystery.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Yep. I mean, you know, like, I know it's just, it's completely crazy. It's just, I mean, right. Despite all the facts, despite all the evidence, you know, right in your face, it's like, you know, let's just...
Just about like, well, what can be done? I think, you know, there's a lot of people on the ground trying to, you know, interrupt processes, to call out what's actually happening, to expose the realities of, you know, of what's happening behind the scenes or what politicians are not doing. But I think what's really going to hold anybody accountable is if people come out and take a stand and really, hold elected officials accountable who are greenlighting all of these policies and processes. If people take a stand that, you know, profit making for these developments and for people's political careers are not going to be, it's not okay that that's, you know, put over, you know, people's lives and people's, you know, day-to-day realities. Like it's gonna require people to show up, you yeah. know, and to take a real stand, and to, you know, not to compromise on, you know, getting a few crumbs, but to really take a stand and stand up for our communities, against profit making. And it's clear that politicians are not going to take that stand unless people hold them accountable to that. And so, you know, the rally on Martin Luther King Day was, you know, an effort to try to get people out to recognize that and to take a stand. And that we've been going out to City Hall on a monthly basis to make our voices heard and to try to gather people more and more from around the city, people who are, you know, feeling... who are feeling the impact of the displacement and the development, and people who are just sick and tired of the crap that we have to deal with on a day-to-day basis, you know, just to live regular lives and to have our communities safe and a place where our children can grow up and flourish, you know, to have basic, you know, to have, you know, the basic needs of people's lives meant that we have to like fight this hard. You know, we want everybody to come out, and take a stand and, join us and, to look out for the posts of when we're going to be out there next and to fight in their own communities also, and to connect with each other to take those stands. That's what we really need.
I hear you, and I've been saying this for decades. Like I shared a little bit. I mean, it's ridiculous how much the vulnerable people have to fight just to live like a basic life. I mean, that's completely ridiculous. So your website, it's called peoplefirstnyc.org, and there's also the Zoned Out book, Displacement. Sorry, that thing is in the way. Race, Displacement, and City Planning in New York City. And I'm sure the same thing goes in other cities around the country. If it's going on here, it's going on everywhere, I'm sure.
Yeah.
So say your name.
This is Irene Shen with the Coalition to Protect Chinatown in the Lower East Side.
And David.
David Hsu. Also with the Coalition to Protect Chinatown Lower East Side.
Thank you so much, and I hope to meet you in person at the next rally.
Yeah, that'd be great.
Okay.
Thanks for having us.
Have a nice weekend.
You too.
I'll be going to D.C., so pray for me.
All right. Sounds good.
Okay. Bye.
Thanks, Catherine. Bye.
You're welcome.